The movie National Treasure is an absolute classic, and lots of Freemasons got their start in the craft by watching that movie. But does National Treasure actually reveal any Masonic secrets? Let's find out. Welcome to the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry channel. I'm Maynard Edwards, 32nd degree, KCCH, Scottish Rite Freemason, your host here on the channel. Please take a moment and subscribe. We're on our way to 5,000 subscribers, and we would love to count you as one of them. If you're a brother, or you've got a question, or you just want to say hi, drop it in the comment section below, and please do give us a thumbs up and share the video. It does help us to make more. The movie National Treasure is a fantastic film, and I'll admit, when I first saw it, I really had very little exposure to what Freemasonry was all about. And the movie comes off a little bit like a history lesson. And there are a lot of Freemasons who watched that movie for the first time and got interested in Freemasonry because of it. And so for that reason, National Treasure is a fantastic movie. But it's definitely not a history lesson, nor is it a lesson on Masonic symbolism or anything of the sort. So we're probably going to have to do several videos on National Treasure just to separate the fact from the fiction. Now, I don't want you to think that the movie is anything less than a great story and a lot of fun to watch. So if for some reason you live in a cave and you've never seen National Treasure with the great Nicolas Cage, go ahead and watch it. It's a fantastic movie. Again, it's not a history lesson, nor is it going to give you any real information about Freemasonry. So let's start with a couple of things in the film that I think you should know before you get too far into what's real and what's not. The whole story starts to unfold from a revelation from Charles Carroll of Carrollton, signer of the Declaration of Independence and Freemason.
Charles Carroll was the last surviving signer of the Declaration of Independence. He was also a member of a secret society known as the Masons.
So let's talk a little bit about the fact and the fiction about that. Charles Carroll of Carrollton was, in fact, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, and he was the oldest surviving Declaration signer. He died in 1832 at age 95. I'm pretty sure all that business about going to the White House to try and visit Andrew Jackson, that's probably made up for fun for the story. And I doubt very seriously he entrusted his Masonic secrets to his coachman, which is the member of the Gates family that passed it to his grandson and so on and so forth until it ended up with Benjamin Gates, who is the character played by Nicolas Cage in the film. The reason I know that Charles Carroll of Carrollton would not have given his Masonic secret to the member of the Gates family was because Charles Carroll of Carrollton definitely, 100% positive, was not a Freemason. He was an absolute staunch Catholic. In this picture, you see Charles Carroll of Carrollton wearing a Masonic ring, but there's no chance that would have happened because at that time, Catholics, if it was known that they were Freemasons, they would have been excommunicated. Now, that rule has changed a little bit, and I'm not an expert on Catholic dogma, but I will tell you, I don't think you get excommunicated for being a Freemason anymore. Now, Masons, again, have no problem with Catholics joining our ranks. It's entirely up to a man, and whether or not he wants to join is between him and his God. But we are 100% certain that Charles Carroll of Carrollton was not a Freemason, and therefore would not have been the sole surviving person to hand down any Masonic secrets to anyone. So, the very genesis of the story starts off with a Masonic tale that is just there for fun. It's not a fact. Next, let's take a look at this treasure and a couple of important symbols. Now, right here, this medallion or coin or whatever the heck this thing is has three symbols we need to look at: the square and compasses, the unfinished pyramid, and the all-seeing eye or the eye of providence. Now, the square and compasses are absolutely a Masonic symbol. And we really don't know how old that symbol is. No one really knows when the first use of that symbol came about. There are some people who trace it back as far as the time of Confucius. I'm not so sure about that one. However, in combination with this pyramid and all-seeing eye, I think that is entirely anachronistic. In other words, it don't belong there. Next, let's look at the unfinished pyramid, or just the pyramid in general. A lot of people think that this is a Masonic symbol, and really, it kind of isn't. It is indeed included on the back of the dollar bill, and it's the part of the Great Seal of the United States, and people think that because a lot of founding fathers were Masons, that this must be a Masonic symbol, much like the Eye of Providence, which we will get to in a minute. However, it's just not. The guy who brought the unfinished pyramid to the American zeitgeist was a guy named Francis Hopkinson, and he first used it in association with a $50 note. In other words, money. It was on money as a $50 bill, basically, an early version of the $50 bill. That unfinished pyramid was his idea. It was then adopted after the Constitutional Convention, when they wanted to put together a Great Seal of the United States. There were a lot of different ideas kicked around about this, and eventually they did settle on using that unfinished pyramid with 13 steps, alluding to the 13 original colonies, or 13 original states at that point. None of the guys responsible for that were Freemasons. The only one who was responsible for the printing and all of that was Benjamin Franklin. And while Franklin was absolutely a Freemason, they consulted on him not for the symbology, but rather for his expertise as a printer, because don't forget, that's how Franklin made his fortune, as a printer. So, is that pyramid and its association with Freemasonry real? No. The pyramid, again, not a Masonic symbol and anachronistic to the time. Finally, let's talk about that all-seeing eye, aka the Eye of Providence. It indeed has been adopted by Freemasons, but it was pretty late to the Masonic party. Freemasons didn't start really using the Eye of Providence until 1797, when Thomas Smith Webb produced the Freemason's monitor. Now, a monitor is sort of like the cliff notes for Masonic rituals. Thomas Smith Webb's Freemason's monitor, wow, that is hard to say, came out in 1797, and it included the Eye of Providence, or the all-seeing eye, as a Masonic symbol, which it's taken as the eye of God. And the idea is God is always watching us. God knows what we're doing. And so the Eye of Providence became a Masonic symbol right around that time, probably a few years before, and certainly has been used ever since. But would it have been as part of this Templar treasure or this ancient Egyptian treasure or founding father treasure? No. So all three of these symbols I look at as being anachronisms, meaning they don't belong there. They're completely out of time. Now we need to discuss an idea that comes up in the film that really is going to tick some people off. And we did a whole video on this, so let's watch a little of the movie.
They brought the treasure back to Europe and took the name the Knights Templar. Over the next century, they smuggled it out of Europe, and they formed a new brotherhood called the Freemasons, in honor of the builders of the Great Temple.
The thinking is, and there are a lot of people who believe this, that the Knights Templar basically went into hiding and became what we today call the Freemasons. This is what we refer to as the romantic history of Freemasonry. It is not the authentic history of Freemasonry. Freemasons would really love to believe that we are tied to those ancient and honorable Knights Templar. So much so that Freemasons in the 1700s actually started a Masonic order known as the Knights Templar, which still exists today and is very popular. It's part of the York Rite of Freemasonry. But does that indicate that the Knights Templar from the Crusades in the 1300s eventually became the Freemasons? No. Historically, there is no proof of that. And there are a lot of people who want it to be true. But just because you want it to be true doesn't mean it's true. And there's just no evidence to support that. I've done a whole video on this with Brother Art De Hoyas, who is the Grand Archivist of the Scottish Rite. And he's an expert on all things Masonry. And believe me, if anybody had found that information, Art would know about it. And it just isn't. So check out that video if you want to get into that. And I know there are a lot of Masons who are going to just pick on me and say, well, we just haven't found the... habeas corpus, dude, produce the body. Let's see some evidence. And then we can talk about it. But there just isn't any. And Yeah, it'd be great. It'd be great if Abraham Lincoln was a Mason. A lot of people think, oh, he was going to be, but he wasn't. There's a lot of speculation about a lot of these things, but that doesn't make it true. So as much as people want to believe it, it's just not the case. And finally, for this video, the Silence Do Good letters.
What's an Ottendorf cipher?
It's just codes.
Each of these three numbers corresponds to a word and a key.
Usually a random book or a newspaper article.
In this case, the Silence Do Good letters. So it's like the page number of the key text, the line on the page, and the letter in that line.
So Silence Do Good was the pen name of Benjamin Franklin, who in fact was a Freemason. In fact, he was a grandmaster of Masons in Pennsylvania. But let's unpack a few things before we go connecting Silence Do Good to Freemasonry. First, Silence Do Good was the pen name used by a young Ben Franklin to get published in his brother's newspaper, the New England Courant. Young Ben wanted to write for the paper, and like all older brothers, Ben's older brother said, "Get lost, twerp, we're not putting you in the paper." So Ben, being a crafty young fellow, decided to create the character of Mrs. Silence Do Good, and he wrote 16 letters to the editor, and he would leave them on the porch of his brother's print shop. The brother got them and he read them and like, hey, these are great, I'm going to publish them. So Silence Do Good's letters were in fact published in Franklin's older brother's paper, the New England Courant. Here's where the connection to Freemasonry falls apart, and therefore this as a linchpin of the story also falls apart. Benjamin Franklin was about 16 years old in 1722 when the Silence Do Good letters were written and published. He didn't become a Freemason for another 10 years in 1732. Therefore, if he were Masonically hiding some things inside the Silence Do Good letters, he was doing it with some great psychic ability because he didn't become a Mason until pretty much a decade later. Also, the original Silence Do Good letters, they don't exist. So if you go to the Franklin Institute and ask to see them, they're going to show you the same photocopies or Xerox or printings or whatever they've got from Google that you can find yourself. The letters themselves are lost to history. Now, they were printed in the newspaper and copies of that were maintained. So we have the text of them. We know what they said. But the actual longhand written out things that were left on the front porch by young Benjamin Franklin for his brother to find, they no longer exist, and they certainly were not influenced by Freemasonry in any way. Maybe you disagree with me on some of this. I would love to hear your comments. Drop your comment below. We're definitely going to have to take another look at some of the symbols in National Treasure. These are just the first four that jumped out at me. And if there's one that you want me to talk about, again, drop it in the comment below. But don't forget to subscribe. I'm Maynard Edwards, 32nd Degree KCCH, Scottish Rite Freemason, and we'll catch you next time right here on the channel.